We light our candle of concern this week for all those in need of care. People in hospitals, nursing homes, retirement homes, assisted living in their own homes. We also pray for frontline staff who take care of those who are most vulnerable, workers who grow weary, stretched beyond their endurance, nurses, personal support workers, doctors, therapists, cleaners, dietary and activation staff. Let us not take their sacrifices for granted. We light the Christ candle as a reminder of the one who calls us to be the church, and by whose Spirit we can be assured that we will never walk this journey alone.
Thank you. Greetings, my name is Brianna Shea. Welcome to the church service today. We are now many weeks into the quarantine, and although many tragedies have occurred due to the pandemic, it has also exemplified our ability to join together. Through the 193 member states within the United Nations and the 194 member states within the World Health Organization, working together to keep everyone safe during the pandemic and working to develop a vaccine. Every country and every culture has been touched by this. No matter the beliefs or spoken languages, we have all bonded together to fight COVID-19. God has blessed us with this chance to understand, learn, and fight hand in hand with our neighbors. Let's use this chance to learn to speak and actively listen, no matter the cultural differences, belief differences, and language differences, as God intended. Enjoy the service.
Hello and welcome. Let us center ourselves by joining in our call to worship. Creator God, we can't see the wind blow, yet we can see the dust and the leaves swirl, the grass wave, pushed by the wind. We can't see the wind blow, yet we can unfurl our sails, see them puff with air, and move our boats along. And we wonder, is that how the Holy Spirit works? Moving the ordinary, making it extraordinary, seeing our potential and giving it worth? Take us as we are, O God, and fill us with the Spirit's power. Let the rush of the wind propel us forward and challenge us. Let the calm breezes comfort and soothe us. And may we always know that your Spirit lives in and through us. Let us pray. Send your Spirit upon us this day, O God. Excite us, move us, help us to turn the best of intentions into the best of deeds. Inspire us to be prophets, visionaries, dreamers. Fill us with courage and with hope that the good we do today will help to shape our tomorrows. Amen.
Well, good morning, friends. Dave Charles here, your mission and service enthusiast. As you can tell, I'm sporting a very stylish face mask that my wife Joan made. And I thought since I wanted to venture into our beautiful sanctuary, which I haven't been into probably for 2 months at least, I wanted to have a chance to introduce the video you'll be seeing called Our Generation, about young people in the church and the work that they're doing for mission and service. But also give you greetings from the sanctuary, which you haven't been in many, many months. So just to let you know, it's beautifully clean and just waiting us to return. This morning, in addition to the Our Generation, which talks about a lot of different things going on in M&S, I wanted to mention something that we're reading this morning in about an hour at our Thursday morning book study. And as you may know, it's called We Make the Road by Walking by Brian McLarlin. And this morning's is a very, very interesting chapter after Easter, and it talks about the uprising of fellowship and how really the gift of Easter and the resurrection was to encourage all of us as Christians to love one another no matter where we are at in our lives, which was not typical at that time. And that is really the difference in society that we make, is that our doors are open to everyone. So I hope you will enjoy today's Minutes for Mission, and I look forward to seeing you again very soon. Take care, all.
I see you standing around in a strange situation that needs to be turned around. Now tell us, what can we do? I've walked through every day just wondering about everything I'd have to say to get at him. Something to remind us of what we've been called to this earth for. So just give us Jesus, and we swear the world and change the world with Him. Now watch our generation begin. Now watch our generation begin.
Everyone,
that transformation that we desperately need. Now we need a song, something to move us along. A rousing cry to truth. So just give us Jesus, and we will give our all. We will give. Watch our generation begin. So watch our generation begin.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Pamela Shea. Today I will read the Good News translation of Acts chapter 2, verses 1 to 21, the coming of the Holy Spirit. When the day of Pentecost came, all the believers were gathered together in one place. Suddenly there was a noise from the sky, which sounded like a strong wind blowing, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then they saw what looked like tongues of fire, which spread out and touched each person there. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to talk in other languages as the Spirit enabled them to speak. There were Jews living in Jerusalem, religious people who had come from every country in the world. When they heard this noise, a large crowd gathered. They were all excited because all of them heard the believers talking in their own languages. In amazement and wonder, they exclaimed, "These people who are talking like this are Galileans. How is it then that all of us hear them speaking in our own native languages? We are from Parthia and Media and Elam, from Mesopotamia and Judah and Cappadonia, from Pontus and Asia, from Phrygia and from Pamphylia, from Egypt and the regions of Libya near Cyrene. Some of us are from Rome, both Jews and Gentiles converted to Judaism, and some of us are from Crete and Arabia. Yet all of us hear them speaking in our own languages from the great things that God has done." Amazed and confused, they kept asking each other, "What does this mean?" But others made fun of the believers, saying, "These people are drunk." Then Peter stood up with the other 11 apostles and in a loud voice began to speak to the crowd. "Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem, listen to me and let me tell you what this means. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It is only 9 o'clock in the morning. Instead, this is what the prophet Joel spoke about. This is what I do in the last days, God says.
I will pour out my spirit on everyone. Your sons and daughters will proclaim my message. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will have dreams. Yes, even my servants, both men and women, will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will proclaim my message. I will perform miracles in the sky above and wonders on the earth below. There will be blood, fire, and thick smoke. The sun will be darkened, and the moon will turn red as blood before the great and glorious day of the Lord comes. And then whoever calls out for the Lord to help will be saved. Praise be to God. Amen.
Hello, my name is Brianna, and today we are reading 1 Corinthians 4:13. I always give thanks to my God for you because of the grace he has given you through Christ Jesus. For in union with Christ, you have become rich in all things, including all speech and all knowledge. The message about Christ has become so firmly established in you that you have not failed to receive a single blessing as you wait for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. He will also keep you firm to the end so that you will always be faultless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is to be trusted, and God, who called you to have fellowship with his Son Jesus Christ our Lord, by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ, I appeal to all of you, my friends, to agree in what you say, so that there will be no divisions among you. Be completely united with only one thought and one purpose. For some people from Chloe's family have told me quite plainly, my friends, that there are quarrels among you. Let me put it in this way. Each one of you says something different. One says, I follow Paul. Another, I follow Apollos. Another, I follow Peter. And another, I follow Christ. Christ has been divided into groups. Was it Paul who died on the cross for you? Were you baptized as Paul's disciples?
In the midst of the pandemic, the Holy Spirit came, not like a dove with flutter and coo, but as a wind, a God-awful wind that blew through every corner and crevice, with billows of dust flying from the traditions that hadn't been given even a once-over in decades, if not hundreds of years. Not like a still small voice, but as an ever-burning bush, a pillar of flame, as a flash of love so powerful that even those of us with the most closed hearts knew that everything was aglow, everything was in the open, everything was lit by the light of God's grace, the Holy Spirit's power. Perhaps that flame will burn away our babble. Perhaps that wind will force us to breathe deep. Perhaps those wings will mask our mouths, even as they unmask our hearts, that we might be ready to live God's economy, where the naked are clothed, the hungry fed, the parched provided with cool water, and in Jubilee, the abundance of creation is removed from the grasp of those who amass, that all creation, all our relations would have life. Life is all its fullness. Spirit of the living God, blow through our upper rooms. Spirit of the living God, blow up our marketplaces. Spirit of the living God, blow in this church dispersed. And push us again into who we truly are. Spirit of the living God, Pentecost bright power, fall afresh on me. Amen.
Thank you. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth be acceptable to you, O God, and may they inspire us to be our very best selves. Amen. Earlier in our service, we sang one of the hymns that is nearest and dearest to my heart, Spirit, Spirit of Gentleness. I heard someone a short while ago refer to it as that nice new hymn. I guess when you consider the long history of our attempts to articulate our faith through song, it is a new hymn. But would you be surprised to know that it was written 45 years ago? The words are powerful. Over the eons you call to each thing. Wake from your slumbers and rise on your wings. You call from tomorrow. You break ancient schemes. From the bondage of sorrow, the captives dream dreams. Our women see visions. Our men clear their eyes. With bold new decisions, your people arise. The hymn speaks of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit blowing through people on the rush of the wind. It speaks to winds of change and a yearning for something beyond ourselves. For me personally, it is a challenge to action, an invitation to aspire to more. More compassion, more justice, more love. Our scripture reading this morning from the book of Acts is full of rich symbolism. It speaks in terms of wind and fire, classic images for the Spirit in the Hebrew Bible. In Jerusalem, on the day of Pentecost, 50 days after Passover, the Spirit descended on the community that was assembled all together in one place. For quite some time, many of them had lived in fear, fear of persecution or even death for being associated with the likes of Jesus, fear of being betrayed themselves if they were found out. And yet, we are told, suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. The gift of other languages was bestowed. Jews from many nations and languages who were living in Jerusalem were able to understand the speakers and each other. This turned the idea of the Tower of Babel we read about in Genesis on its head. Suddenly, they were no longer divided by language groups. They could no longer focus on their differences, their insecurities, and their fears. Rather, they were drawn together by their similarities and their strength in numbers. However it all transpired, whether it was symbolism or the retelling of the event by the early church leaders, or it came about exactly as it was written, something happened that ignited those people, that inspired them. Whether they realized it or not, that inspiration led them to be the church. And now, more than 2,000 years later, we still honor Pentecost as the anniversary of the church. And I have to ask, what inspires us to be the church in the 21st century? Do we still feel the Holy Spirit blow through us on the rush of the wind? Do we have visions? Do we face our fears, our insecurities, shake ourselves out of our comfort zones, open our eyes to the need around us, and with bold new decisions, do we arise? Do we have the courage to change the world because the very Spirit that lived in Jesus is living and breathing in us? When it comes to the church, quite frankly, feeling comfortable makes me uncomfortable. settling into the status quo, creating the right liturgies, establishing the right creeds, forming the right committees, not asking a lot of questions, I believe does a good job at containing the Holy Spirit so that it's manageable for us. Just follow the rules, don't rock the boat too much, and we're content. But as every good firefighter knows, containment is a step towards putting the fire out. Jesus' life was about anything but containment. He lived a life that reflected a subversive and radical message of love and compassion and justice. He gave a voice to the voiceless, a place to belong for those who did not. He stood up against systemic domination and the imbalances of power. He was passionate about providing a full and abundant life for everyone. I believe that we sometimes misinterpret Jesus' message to us. As a church, sometimes we are in danger of substituting righteousness for compassion. Let's not be part of that world, the world that is perceived as sinful. The solution is to keep ourselves righteously apart from it. Take the moral ground. Avoid the blemishes of the world outside of our own self-determined protective walls. Jesus was a man of compassion, selfless for people from all walks of life, in all situations, and he calls us to compassion. Jesus also calls us to have a passion for justice, not the kind of justice that punishes, but the kind that restores balance. Jesus rallied against oppressive systems, political, economic, and religious systems that supported the self-interests of a few in an elite group and had a devastating effect on the masses. A few benefited at the expense of the many. And yet, how many times do we hear religion and politics don't mix? How many opportunities do we miss to have the wind and the fire of the Holy Spirit work in us and through us as the hands and feet of Jesus while we live in silos? This past week, I was devastated by the revelation of the deplorable conditions in many of Ontario's long-term care facilities. Like most of you, I'm sure, I was horrified, moved to tears, in fact. We hear daily reports of how there never seems to be enough in our society as a whole. Not enough food, not enough housing, not enough mental health resources, not enough access to good health care. So like many of you, I am not at all surprised. Over the years, I've listened to stories, advocated for people, tried to empower people to advocate for themselves and their loved ones, only to feel like our efforts fell on deaf ears. Frankly, the late breaking news was not news to many of us. The system seemed to be too well entrenched, too powerful, with so many layers that it would appear that one hand doesn't know what the other is doing. And throughout the layers, beginning at the bottom, are vulnerable people. People who feel that they have no voice, that if they speak up about things, things will just get worse. From patients to frontline workers to advocates, individual voices, one by one, fail to change the status quo. Until May 2020, when the carefully crafted, protected systems fell apart, at least in some areas. Ironically, COVID-19, probably one of the most challenging health crises we have been faced with in decades, caused the cracks in the systems designed to take care of those who are most vulnerable to become so evident, so massive, that it will take a seismic change in thinking and doing to restore balance and justice. I can't help but draw parallels between the current situation and that of the early church. Jesus was put to death for fighting against inequality, for fighting systems that enrich the few and oppress the many. I think he must have felt so alone sometimes, don't you? After his resurrection, his followers hid away. But then they were filled with the Holy Spirit and inspired to change the world, to make it a better world for all. What about us? When we see neglect where there should be compassion, when we see injustice, do we continue to sit in our comfortable pews and justify our inaction by simply saying, politics and religion don't mix, or that's terrible, someone should do something about it? Don't worry, I'm not naive enough to believe that there are easy answers. This is going to take a lot of work, and a lot of hard conversations, and a great deal of sacrifice at many levels. It can't simply be about blame and name-calling. It must be about finding solutions and about never repeating this ugly situation. And this is just one of the many hard realities in our world today. It's overwhelming. It's hard to know where to even start. But as Christians, we cannot take ourselves out of the conversation, out of the solutions. We must find courage, be inspired, let the rush of the wind surround us and draw us in, like the fire, let the fire in our bellies be reignited. Standing on the sidelines and holding our breath, hoping that this will all work out, hoping that someone will do something, isn't an option. This is about taking care of people. And this is our business as Christians. Together we can do this, God being our helper. Let us pray. Eternal God, you come with fire and wind, daring us to free us from our rigid thinking, our self-made walls. Yet we, as your people, are sometimes reluctant to look beyond ourselves, to find ways to find the world, to fill the world with compassion, to fight for what is right and what is fair. Forgive our complacency. And empower us with your Spirit. Amen.
And only pray, Father.
Let us bow our heads in prayer. Loving God, sometimes it's difficult for us to be inspired. Sometimes just getting through another day relatively unscathed is the goal. For some of us, the ache of isolation and loneliness is always just below the surface. For some of us, the pressure of taking care of families, educating our children at home, not feeling secure in the workplace, not being with our loved ones, worrying about those we love, feeling overwhelmed. Well, sometimes there's little room for being inspired. We know that the winds of change are beginning to blow, that inevitable change that brings hope and relief, but also anxiety and uncertainty. Help us to hear the small voice in the midst of the rushing wind that says, "Be still and know that I am God." We pray for families, for parents and children, grandparents, aunts and uncles and cousins, all those who are struggling to adjust to a new reality, a new closeness, or for many, distance. Hear us as we remember those who are near and dear to our hearts. We remember especially the family and the church family of Reverend Dr. Alan Bennett at Wall Street United Church in Brockville as they are faced with his life-threatening illness. May your love surround them in these difficult days. We pray for those who are most vulnerable. The cracks in the systems that were built to protect them are now so visible that we can only shake our heads and vow to learn from our collective not knowing, neglect even, and to build a better, more caring future. Give us the courage to get sucked into the whirlwind that will hopefully sweep across this country until we make things right. Until we cease to turn a blind eye and ignore the need, until we as citizens of this country no longer excuse the disregard for human dignity because the price we pay may come at a cost to us, until we are truly the hands and feet of Jesus in this hurting world. Empower us. Inspire the leaders of this land of plenty that we call Canada to make wise decisions about the welfare of everyone, not just a privileged few. Give us all the courage to make sacrifices. And now we offer prayers in silence for those things that we hold in our hearts. Be with us, O God. Help us to appreciate the unexpected joys that come our way in the midst of these difficult times, and give us strength to face what each day brings. We ask in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
As we leave this space of worship today, know that you will never walk alone. Hold your head up high. Don't be afraid. May the warmth of the Holy Spirit enter your heart and give you courage and peace. May you be inspired to do one thing. Start with one thing that touches the heart of someone else. God is calling you to make a difference. And now may God's love and grace carry you through this week and forevermore. Amen.